The Closers by Paul Guyot. Do you think about death a lot? Dennis Collins was standing on line with Cindy Bradshaw, but he was thinking back to last night when he was listening to Night Lies, the late-night talk radio show hosted by Stella. A girl had called in and asked what happens to a person after they die, and is it any different than when they're killed? Dennis had the same thoughts now and then.
"Go," said Cindy.
Dennis looked up and saw the pharmacist waiting. The people behind them were hemming and hawing, making the point that their lives were on hold while Dennis stood there daydreaming. "I could kill all of you with that box of condoms," thought Dennis. Cindy and Dennis stepped up, and Cindy handed in the prescription. The pharmacist asked for a name.
"Bradshaw," said Cindy.
The pharmacist typed away, and Dennis lost himself in his earliest memory of death, going deer hunting with his father. He smiled, thinking back to those halcyon nights, sitting in his car seat in the back of his father's battered Plymouth Fury as they drove the winding roads up through the Coconino National Forest hour after hour, until little Dennis felt the torque of the Fury's 360 as Daddy mashed the gas pedal, followed by the percussive energy of impact as the Fury slammed directly into a headlights hypnotized deer at 75 miles per hour.
"Says here you're allergic to penicillin," said the pharmacist.
"No, I'm not," said Dennis, popping back to the present.
"He's talking to me, sweetie," said Cindy, then to the pharmacist. "It's not for me, it's for my mother, Ellen Bradshaw."
"Do you want to wait for this?" the pharmacist asked. "It'll take about 20 minutes. Cindy looked at her Daniel Roth, then turned to Dennis.
"Axelrod's retirement thingy is this morning. We should get going."
To the pharmacist, she said, "I'll come back at lunch." Dennis and Cindy left the pharmacy and walked two blocks east, then two blocks north. On the way, Dennis glanced a few times at his girlfriend's ass, one of those perfect heart-shaped asses, and listened to her.
"I just don't know if they'll ever give me a chance," she said.
"Why wouldn't they?" Dennis said. "You're a good worker, you know the biz. You just have to put your time in like everyone else. Shit, I spent 3 years in the mailroom before making junior VP, and 4 years doing that before becoming a VP.
"I think the company is biased against women," said Cindy.
"Stop thinking so much," Dennis said. "Look at Lila or Carol, they're VPs. You just have to put your time in." He watched Cindy's mouth start to open and said,
"Don't say Hanrahan. That guy was an anomaly. He's the only one the company ever promoted straight to executive, and that was only because he came up with the whole NC idea."
As they waited for a light to change, Dennis said,
"I've got an idea. Why don't you enter the contest?"
"That idea thing?" asked Cindy.
"Come on."
"Seriously, why not you?" he said as they crossed the street. "It's just thinking up something to help the company. Hell, Wally won it 1 month because he figured out a better place for the fucking water cooler. And we know you have no trouble thinking about things."
"Stop," she said, smacking his arm. "What's the point? It's not like the winner becomes a VP or anything."
"The point," Dennis explained, "is to impress the execs. Show them your VP material. Besides, you get a nice blender, too." Cindy smiled.
"I would love a new blender."
They reached the 47-story glass and steel edifice that was home to Omnidat.
"Okay, I'll give it a shot," Cindy said. "I can come up with an idea or two."
She put her arms around Dennis and said,
"Thanks, sweetie, for talking to me. I feel much better. But did we solve your problems?"
"I don't have any problems, babe. Life is good." And they entered the building.
"Morning, Jasper," they both said to the hulking security guard manning the reception desk and the bank of monitors behind it.
"Morning, ladies," replied Jasper.
Dennis always wondered if that was Jasper's way, kidding out of affection, or if he really questioned Dennis's manhood. He caught Jasper checking out Cindy's ass as they stepped onto the elevator. Dennis puffed out his ordinary chest and draped an arm over Cindy. "I know 68 different ways to kill you," Dennis thought as the doors closed.
Omnidat occupied the top three floors of the building. The 47th floor, the penthouse, was the domain of Edgar Maddox, founder and CEO of Omnidat. The stocky, venerable 80-year-old made appearances from time to time on the lower floors, but for the most part, Edgar Maddox remained on the 47th floor. The only time anyone was invited to join him up there was when a VP had been exalted to the revered position of executive. It was the ultimate, the brass ring, the end of the rainbow for an Omnidat employee. Rumors abounded about what went on during the ceremony. Drinking unblended scotch and smoking cigars with a man, doing hookers and cocaine, learning all the company secrets. But no one really knew. The few lucky enough to experience it never had time to discuss what went down, as they almost immediately began traveling the world. One of the perks, along with a fat seven-figure income, overseeing Omnidat's global operations. There were 9 executives in the company of 381 employees. Dennis Collins desperately wanted to be number 10. The elevator doors opened to the 45th floor. Dennis kissed Cindy and stepped off. He said hello to Marjorie, the office manager, who nodded from behind the large kidney-shaped reception desk under a metallic sign that read, Omnidat, tomorrow's technology serving today's needs. The 45th floor was one giant area, stuffed to the gills with row after row of fabricated cubicles where VPs and junior VPs all worked together in a man-made prairie dog town. Dennis walked down the main aisle, tossing nondescript greetings to co-workers who did the same, finally coming to his cube, which looked exactly the same as everyone else's. Dennis sat down in front of his computer. He stared at his reflection in the dark monitor for a brief moment, as he did every morning before firing up the PC. 40 seconds later, he entered his password, then his second password, and saw his next bond was already waiting for him. He briefly thought he might make the chart this year. He typed in another password and looked at the photo and dossier on his screen. Robert Bob Carmichael lived on Palm Lane in Scottsdale, Arizona, had a wife, 3 kids, and 2 dogs. Bob worked at a chemical plant. Dennis scanned the photo just like his training had taught him. First give a quick glance, then go back and study every inch. Start at the top of the head, commit to memory the shape of the skull, then slowly move down the forehead, picking out any scars, bumps, fissures, etc., before focusing on the eyes. Color, size, shape, how far apart, how far from the nose, how far from the temples. Then do the same with the rest of the face, and finally, when you have all the finite details locked into your brain, you look at the triangle, the distance from the corners of the eyes to the center of the mouth. It was something the government used in identifying potential terrorists from security camera photos. Regardless of how much plastic surgery one has, it is virtually impossible to alter the God-given triangle of the eyes and mouth. Dennis knew this was all overkill. Bob had no idea he had become a client of Omnidat. He would have no reason to have surgery done. Bob was living as if he had all the time in the world. Poor Bob, thought Dennis. Then he thought, why did I think poor Bob?